To what will I compare this generation? It is like a child sitting in the marketplaces calling out to others. We played the flute for you and you didn't dance. We sang a funeral song and you didn't mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he has a demon. Yet the human came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunk, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. But wisdom proved to be right by her works. At that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you've hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and have shown them to babies. Indeed, Father, this brings you happiness. My Father has handed all things over to me. No one knows the Son except the Father, and nobody knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wants to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are struggling hard and carrying heavy loads, and I will give you rest. Put on my yoke and learn from me. I'm gentle and humble. You will find rest for yourselves. My yoke is easy to bear, and my burden is light. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
It's 5 a.m. Do you know where your children are? Mine are in bed. I should be in bed. It's Mother's Day, but I'm not. Wanna know why? Because I'm a clean freak. I am talking freaky deaky Dutch. If you were to lock me away in a white room in a straitjacket, it would actually feel comforting. As long as the walls were spotless and nobody wore shoes. I can actually feel the house getting dirty. Like I have nerve endings in the carpet. And it affects me. Wanna know how? First, I feel distracted. Distracted. D-I-S-O. So see, like right now, I'm thinking of the cleaning supplies I left out and how one of the kids is gonna get up and drink Clorox, and then I'd end up having to call poison control and they'd say, sorry, Mrs. Field, too many times this month, and take my kids away.
Too many times this month, Miss Field. We're here to take your children away.
I've played it all out.
I'm sure you've played this all out.
Which is kind of morbid. After I feel distracted, I feel stressed. Then I have a moment. To Daddy! This is me having a moment with my daughter.
Hey, hon, about the stress level.
What?
Well, it's a little high.
The kind of psycho thing you just did?
Did you just call me psycho?
No.
Did you just call me psycho?
No.
It was a little psycho. This is me having a moment with some helpless newlyweds.
We just wanted to say congratulations! And savor this moment in your life!
So when I started to speak, I thought it would help. But then the words just started coming out of me like lava.
Because you're gonna blink seriously like blink and it's all gonna be over and replaced with just volume. Like just amazing, amazing, beautiful volume.
Look at that. Look at that look on her face. That's the look of a girl whose fairy tale just ended. I murdered it. I am a fairy tale murderer.
It only takes so much before you crack.
I am like the Bruce Banner of stay-at-home moms. He doesn't want to turn into the Hulk. It just happens. Which is exactly how I feel. I love my kids. I love my husband. My minivan is awesome. I have this incredible life. So, why do I feel this way?
Is it just me or can you relate? And I'm not just talking about those of you who are counting down the days till school starts, but also those of you who are dreading, how many?
31.
But those of you who are dreading the start of school, and those of you who are so stressed out about what work that you almost wish you'd be laid off, or how about those of you who are caregivers? And you give and give and give until you reach the point where you really have nothing left to give. Do you ever feel that way? Or how about those of you struggling to make ends meet or dealing with difficult relationships? Or those of you dealing with declining health in yourself or someone you love? Can you relate? Do you ever have those days when you think you just can't take it anymore? When you feel like you're drowning in whatever it is you're drowning in, and you simply don't know what to do or where to turn? And maybe if you're like me at times, you want to just give up and run away to a deserted island somewhere. Monday was one of those days for me. After several nights of lying awake worrying about how we as a church are going to make ends meet when we cut everything we can possibly cut, but we're still 3 months behind on pension and insurance, and I'm waiting for that call from the new DS, who I'm sure won't be as nice or understanding as the former one, I end up exhausted and stressed out and in the midst of one of those minor meltdowns like you saw in that clip. Some of you might call it a pity party, and in some ways it is. But whatever it is, I found myself feeling on Monday alone and unappreciated and unable to do anything right. Now, I could blame it on a full moon, could blame it on hormones, but if I'm honest, I think it has more to do with me trying to do it all on my own, with me trying to shoulder the burden by myself than it does with anything else. I'm not really good at asking for help, and I suspect that that's a trait I share with many of you sitting here today. Anyway, imagine my surprise when I turned to the lectionary to begin planning worship for today and found this passage from Matthew, and it seemed to be literally screaming my name. Glenda, Glenda, pay attention. Come to me, all you who are struggling hard and carrying heavy loads, and I will give you rest. I think a lot of us need to hear those words, do we not? Put on my yoke and learn from me. I am gentle and humble, and you will find rest for yourselves. My yoke is easy to bear and my burden is light. And I'm like, yes, 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 Jesus, yes, this is exactly what I needed to hear today. It's funny how that works, isn't it? Yet, as is almost always the case, when I began to dig deeper into this passage to look at it in its larger context in Matthew, I found that there's more here than first meets the eye. In fact, when Jesus first spoke these words, it seems that he himself was a bit frustrated, exasperated perhaps, with those to whom he was speaking, the good church folk of his day. And he's about had it with all their fickle, critical, wishy-washy, never satisfied, money, belly aching that he can take. Hence the rather sarcastic first few verses. You see, Jesus and his cousin John the Baptist were about as different as two people could be. John was the weird, bug-eating wilderness prophet who came preaching a message of repent now or else. He often referred to his audience as that brood of vipers. Not exactly a message that endeared him to the people he was speaking to. As a result, there were many who were offended by what John said, and by what they saw as his too strict, overly demanding way of discipleship. And they were less than reluctant to share their negative views about John, and otherwise they cropped it out of their life. And then this Jesus fellow comes along with his overly exuberant inclusiveness, where every meal's a party as long as everyone's included. And well, these same folks didn't like that either. Imagine that. They called him a glutton and a drunk, mainly because they didn't approve of the folks he was hanging out with. You see, John was too conservative and Jesus was too liberal, and what most folks wanted was something more middle of the road. Sorry, I can't seem to get this to stay on my ear. What most folks wanted was something more middle of the road, something that really didn't require any change on their part, which is what I think basically lies at the heart of the problem. You see, people like things the way they are, and the people to whom these words were originally spoken thought that they had it all under control. That was until Crazy John and this Jesus fella come along spouting messages that basically threatened their autonomy, their self-sufficiency, their self-reliance. And again, I think that's part of the problem for many of us, especially when we find ourselves overwhelmed and seemingly unable to cope with the things that life brings our way, is this need for autonomy, this need to handle it on our own, to take care of it by ourselves, to be fiercely independent and not need anyone else. And oftentimes that includes not needing God. The problem is that when we take this approach, we cut ourselves off from the greatest gift God has to offer us, the gift of God's presence, be that through the Holy Spirit about which we sang earlier, or through other people, people that God places in our lives to be our helpmates, our encouragers, our supporters, our sources of strength. Those who can offer a listening ear and a caring heart. In our culture, we've been taught that self-sufficiency, that being able to do things on our own, that being able to take care of ourselves is the thing that we should value above all else. But that's not the way it works in God's kingdom. In this passage, Jesus not only calls into question those assumptions about self-sufficiency and that whole way of viewing life, but instead he paints a wholly different picture about what life in the kingdom of God can and should look like. A picture where God is the one who bears our burden, where God is the one who shows up in the midst of our need, where God is the one who comes alongside of us, walking with us, loving us, encouraging us, supporting us, giving us strength to face and deal with whatever life brings our way. And nowhere is this more evident than in the cross. For it is the cross that demonstrates fully God's willingness to embrace all of our life, the good and the bad, even to the point of death in Jesus. The cross tells us that God is willing to do anything to show us God's profound love for and commitment to us, a love and commitment that will not be deterred by. In other words, on the cross, God shows up for us. And while it may not necessarily be what we want, because I really do think we often prefer a God who would just take away our problems rather than help us cope with them, or a God who eliminates challenges rather than equipping us to deal with them, or a God who vanquishes our opponents rather than enabling us to make peace with them, while it may not necessarily be what we want, it's what we need. And as often seems to be the case with Jesus' teachings, it all comes back to relationship. Relationship with God, and also our relationship with others. We have to be willing to let go of this need to control and turn our lives over to God as we understand God. And we also need to be willing to reach out and ask for help from those who God places in our lives. especially those of us fortunate enough to be a part of a community of faith, we don't have to go through the difficult places in life by ourselves. There are people here, people around us, who love us and care about us, who embody God's love in a real way, so that we don't have to feel like we are alone or alienated or in it all by ourselves. But sometimes that requires us setting aside our pride and reaching out and asking for help. And it's amazing what a few phone calls can do when you're willing to pick up the phone and ask for the help you so desperately need. To ask for that support. And it is like that weight, that heavy load, that burden is literally lifted from your shoulders. Because now it's not just all on you, but it's spread out on the shoulders of others. And together, it's much lighter than it is for one alone. You know, God created us to be in relationship with God and with each other for a reason. God never intended us to try to go it alone, to do it all by ourselves. You know, the reality is that things just become too much, too big, too draining, too overwhelming for us to deal with alone. And thank God that He has put people in our lives to help us share those burdens. Monday started out really dark for me. But after talking to some of you, it was like that rainbow that comes out after the storm. And I began to feel like, you know what? I don't carry this alone. This is our church. And we'll figure out a way to catch up together. And we'll figure out what our future is going to look like together. I don't have to make those decisions by myself. And so then I started talking to some of you, and we started thinking of ways to actually make that happen. And it's amazing what sharing and making plans can do to alleviate some of that burden. I think that's what Jesus was talking about when He said, "My yoke is easy, my burden is light." Because when we let go of that need to do it all by ourselves and we turn it over to God and we allow others in God's family to walk with us, it's a little bit easier. And we find the strength and the resources and the encouragement and the love and the empowerment to walk through whatever life brings our way. And I look around this room, and so many of you are carrying burdens that maybe others know nothing about. But if you'll share, if you'll open up, if you allow others to be a part of that, I think you'll find that burden is lightened, and you can walk a little straight. And there's more strength in your steps. And there's more joy in your heart. Thanks be to God for loving us and showing up for us. Thanks be to God for being a part of our lives through the work of the Holy Spirit, but also through the work of God's people. And God's people said,